So this session is called Let's Defend Our Rights, and it is about a range of things. It's about copyright. We've got Oliver Watts here, who is a board member of the Copyright Agency and also head curator at Art Bank. Welcome, Oliver Watts. So what are our rights as practicing artists? How do you defend them? Who's looking out for you? We're going to have a session now where we're not going to offer legal advice because we can't. We're not lawyers. We want to touch on all the different things that are really essential to think about and to champion and to make sure that we as NAVA are hearing about what needs to go again, what needs to go into that revised code. So, this next session is going to involve some sitting and standing and stretching. First of all, everybody stand up and have a very good stretch. Find the ceiling with your fingers. Find the walls. Yeah. All right. Good. Good. There's some bounce there. Oh, I think people have done this before. We're seeing some stretching patterns. Okay. This is good. Okay. So, now, sit down if you've never been paid for work that you've created. Never. Sit down if you've never been paid for work that you've created. Sit down if you were paid at minimum the NAVA rate for that work. If you don't know what the NAVA rate is, you probably weren't paid. So sit down if you were paid at minimum the NAVA rate for that work. Actually looking good so far. Hey? If you were paid at minimum the NAVA rate, sit down. I'm just going to sit down at this point just to be comfy. Sit down if you feel that you were paid fairly for your work. Now sit down if you don't want to be asked a question about that experience that you had. Oh, someone's going to keep standing. There is a lady up the back. All right. So, is there... No, now I'm going to ask you the question. Yes, I'm going to bring a microphone to you. So, was there a particular experience that you had in mind through all of that? A particular experience of being paid for something fairly? Just pass it. Yes, thank you.
No, it's actually probably across the board. Yeah. So I've had fewer experiences of being paid properly, and usually that is in the instance where I set the price for my work, than I have where I've been paid adequately or fairly for the work that I've done. And I've had a few experiences with residencies, with commissions, with where fees are negotiated, and that sort of thing. So, and I've actually been out of the industry for some time, and only recently came back into the industry after completing PhD. And to join academia, as Fiona did, and move. So I'm finding that things are much, much worse now than they have been in the past, and they were pretty dire in the past. So it's quite a wake up call for me at the moment.
Well, that sounds pretty shit. Let's maintain that momentum and go into a next session, and then we're going to have some discussion. Thank you very much for sharing that. Everyone, stand, have a stretch again. Stretching. All right, sit down if you've never shared an image online. Sit down if you've attributed that image every time. Every single time. Sit down if...
Sydney Arthur sat down.
Yeah.
Very well done.
That's a good sitting there, Barry. Sit down if you feel comfortable about how to attribute images and seek permissions. Okay, sit down if you've never had a bad experience in sharing another artist's work? Remain standing or sit down if you don't want to be asked a question right now about that. You guys, tell us about that. Was there something in particular that you were thinking about? So this was the, you were standing because you have had a bad experience or a learning experience in sharing someone else's work and thinking about the attribution of images. Yeah, I'm thinking about your own and other people sharing your own and not attributing.
Yeah.
Tell us about that.
Well, actually, mine's kind of more, not so much online. It's actually funnily enough, I was sitting on a kind of an architectural review board, but as an artist, because I did a lot of projects in sustainability, and it's for a new sustainability centre being built, and the architects kind of rocked up, started presenting the work of the landscape architect, but it's actually public artwork that I'd done, and it's been attributed to the landscape architect. And finally, luckily enough, somebody on the sustainability committee just turned around and looked at me because he recognised my portfolio work and said, "Isn't that your project?" So, and I've also just discovered another public art project that I did some draft designs for a developer. For the DA, and I went and looked at the development, which is now up, and I found both of the artworks actually designed and fabricated. So it's going to be a little bit of a few conversations. Shall we be doing the calm and collective and strategically in a mindful way?
That is so deeply painful.
Yeah, I mean, that was one of the things. I mean, this session's really going to come on from what Nick and Fiona were talking about, which is, I was going to say, really, that once we've got the code, and once we do have laws, we as a community really have to try and change the culture around those laws, which is some form of cultural right or human rights around culture, some broader discussion about the community of art and where Australia is in our culture, which is really what Fiona was talking about through Richard Flanagan's quote. But so, for example, with attribution, I mean, we've only had that law since 2001. And I remember that because we were fighting for it very strongly at the Arts Law when I was there in your building. And I remember the phone calls to Canberra to get that up. So we've only had that since 2001, which is that a long time or is that not a long time? But it's not a long enough time that that's become an Australian industry standard. And there hasn't been, to my knowledge, any precedent set? No one's taken them to court over
two
those
cases.
Things. Two cases already?
Robert, let's hear about those two cases.
Oh, Robert's here, sorry.
We have
Robert
right there, the
Robert.
Executive Director of the Arts Law Centre of Australia.
Sorry, Robin, I would have deferred to you.
That's
if
okay.
Seen you down the left.
Law was 2000, there's been at least two cases. And the thing I would say to artists whose rights have been infringed, for God's sake, contact Arts Law and get advice.
Yeah.
And actually do something about defending your rights, because in a lot of these instances there is something you can do. There's one message I can leave you with in this session is defend your rights. No one's going to do it, and Arts Law's there. We're your friend. We're on your side. We talk to artists every day.
Yeah, and sorry, I agree.
But the two cases, one involved an artist whose work was reproduced in the Women's Day. And it was a portrait of Princess Mary, and the wrong artist was attributed. And that case took 12 months of, the family wrote, the artist and his son wrote letter after letter to the Women's Day just to get the correct attribution. Finally, it went to court, and there were damages awarded to the artist. But they didn't really see it as being that significant. The artist ended up getting a payment of about $10,000. The other case actually involved music and incorrect.
I mean, that's great.
Yeah.
But I mean, Robin, I'm not just defending my lack of knowledge, but it is interesting that those cases haven't filtered down maybe to a lot of people or again to industry. And if they have filtered down, then they've filtered down to maybe the publishing arm or music, which are better, you know, they deal with copyright cases more at a higher level, I think, than the visual arts in general. But yeah, no, it's a very interesting problem. So it's just whether we have to sort of prosecute those things. Was that Ray Hines, or is that the artist's name, or who was the artist?
You're
going to
say that.
No, is it Ray Hines? Was it a royal portrait? No. Okay. But anyway, my point is that, yeah, we really have to fight for these rights, because otherwise they sit there quite fragile in the And so, for example, another thing would be the royalty scheme, which sort of, you know, from 2010, which I don't know if you guys know about, but we've sort of gathered around $6 million since that time for the visual art. And the thing is, if we let that slip, and if you guys don't go into that scheme by becoming members of the copyright agency, then that was looking quite fragile. Starting in 2010, now we could have lost that royalty scheme because of dealers and other, sort of machinations. We could have lost that in 2012, 2013 very easily. But now that it's got a sort of pool of around $6 million, that's now looking a little bit more solid. And that's because as a community of visual artists and members, we're back that scheme. And another scheme that came out just in 2016 is the image royalty scheme, which I think sort of raised, it's connected, but it's raised in the last 2 years $2 million for visual artists that have been handed out to the copyright agency members. So again, I really ask everybody to sort of become involved in those schemes, because the more people we have involved in those schemes, the stronger the schemes are as an arts ecosystem. And it will be the same when this code of practice is finished and finalised. We have to back the scheme that NAVA's creating by going to arts law, by using our advocacy bodies, by using community, by petitioning the local government if it needs an LEP with a proper attribution clause, or the 1% that we've been talking about. We have to tell local government, no, we insist on that 1%. I think that's our job, really. Once the law's set, it's the artist's job to activate those laws and to make sure that those rights are sort of part of the culture.
Now, these royalty schemes that Ollie's just been talking about, does anyone know what those are?
No.
Ollie, tell us
we don't need to, or show of hands or something. It'd be interesting to know how many members are here. But
Who is a member of the copyright agency, which used to be this copy, but now it is all together? Yeah? Okay, so not many of us.
And who received royalty payments this year?
That's some good work, you guys.
Do you want to talk about that, the people that had their hands up there, or that's just self-explanatory? But
yeah, that was surprisingly wealth. Is that what we were talking about before?
What's that?
The unexpected wealth policy.
But yeah, we want to advocate for the copyright agency, because that's money that's ours that we didn't know about, and the only way to access it is to join this organisation. So when I first heard about it, I was a little bit iffy about, they're going to take something that's mine, but that's money that I didn't know was there and had no access to otherwise. So it's been fantastic when we're trying to tell every artist that I know to get on board and sort of claim what's yours.
Yeah. Because somebody's already used your copyrighted material. So for example, if you have done a landscape or a public art project, think of how many, council flyers used that, or magazines published it, or real estate agents use it as an image in part of their sales pitch. Those people have used your image, and that image is in the public domain in a very big way, being used in education, in planning courses. Those things have already been paid for, and you have to access that money through the statutory, licensing.
So basically, when an image is used like that, it does need to be licensed, because it is owned by somebody. Somebody owns that copyright. Copyright agency is the organisation.
Okay, Zan Wimberly is having a conniption down here because she didn't realise. And think of how many places her photos would be.
But it's who, if I photograph an artist's work.
Just don't need the microphone, but everyone on the live stream can hear. So if I photograph an artist's work, and I pay for that by an artist or by a gallery, I still own the copyright on that image unless they have bought that from me.
Yeah.
So then, how does that work for the copyright agencies?
It depends on the photo. Well, again, I'm not giving legal advice, but no, that's a complicated one. But for example, the use of in the Herald, you are let's just say one of your portraits of an artist went in the Herald. Yeah. So you got paid for that job, but other people have used that image for educational purposes or for governmental purposes. So you can get payment through the licensing scheme for that image again.
Yeah. And it's when it's the artwork that I think it gets really complicated, because I don't feel like I should have, I think I had something where Nava in fact used one of my photographs for an annual report, and you wanted to pay me for the copyright of that, and I ended up splitting it 50-50 with the artist. It's a really complicated thing, and I don't know if there is any sort of...
Oh, sorry, maybe Robin could answer.
Can I answer that question?
Yeah.
It's not very complicated.
No, there is a problem.
Sorry, it's not that complicated. There are two copyrights. The artist has a copyright in their work that they've created. They own the copyright. And then the photographer, they have a copyright in their photograph that they've taken. The photographer can't use the work without the permission of the artist.
Yeah.
And, of course, the artist, if they want, they'll pay the photographer for the photograph. And they have to both set out the terms in which they can use the other person's work. It's not that complicated.
But and in our forms, you can put in co-authorship. Mm. Would it be a form of co-authorship?
No, because the artist has the copyright in the underlying work that the photographer... they could come to an agreement. You can always change the basics of copyright through an agreement. So the photographer could agree with the underlying creator. And there are some examples of that. I can think of some examples where we've given some advice and artists have come up with a joint or a shared copyright arrangement. So everything can be changed through agreement. But the basic would be copyright in the photograph and copyright in the underlying artwork, and you both need permission to use the other's work.
Yeah, but this isn't about me using it. This is about someone else using it. And then the royalties going there. And so if I own the copyright on the photograph and the photograph has been used by the Herald,
you'd have to have an agreement with the artist for the work to be used in whatever way it's been used. And I'm not going to give advice because I'm in exactly the same position as Oliver, but that's exactly the sort of question that Arts Law would give you advice on.
It's often not the artist who is commissioning. Sorry.
All right, we're going to have to move on because this
is a very good point.
Yeah. And it goes into this something that Sam faces all the time, and of course, when you're showing your work at the gallery and that gallery brings on a photographer, to photograph the work but also the opening, then of course the gallery will enter into an agreement with the photographer but also with the artist, knowing that yes, you will be, your work will be photographed, here's the... So these are all the things that we need to get in writing, have an agreement on, but also to know what our rights are in those particular situations. So we're talking about a number of things now, the right to your own work, the context in which it's used in the future, the fact that when it's used in particular contexts, because of those licensing and the associated royalties, you have got the right and the opportunity to access that money, which can contribute to your income. And I think it's a really important thing to try and get our heads around.
Yeah. And then, my major point was just really that we're already part, and Zan's point goes to this and what Robin was talking about, we already own now the rights to that work. Mm-hmm. And, for example, you already had moral rights in that landscaping work that you did. I mean, those rights exist, and it's just up to us to make sure that we sort of activate those rights when we can or when we want to, but obviously it's not easy. And sometimes we will need, help advocacy bodies like Arts Law, which is a national body. And, of course, if we all went to Arts Law, then they'd have bigger offices. or you know, or more people, wouldn't they? Really? I mean, you know, we're all part of this ecosystem, and if we all actually used it, then we'd make a healthier system. But it also goes to, you know, what you're saying about the architect, you know, the Architects Institute.
Yeah.
I mean, I know a lot of architects that don't think that advocacy is strong enough in the face of developers and procurement as well. So, you know, Nick suggested that that was a perfect case study, but, you know, like, I think a lot of the, you know, the culture is being affected by, you know, whatever way you want to put at it, sort of, you know, the big end of town, let's say. And, you know, we do need to sort of get together, really, as a, you know, as a community to see what we're going to do there. But, and I can see a lot of people in the room, there are a lot of people that could lead that. You know, so there are people here from the larger galleries, you know, and are they paying for, you know, the digital image rights, for example, or, you know, or do they need to, or how have they organised that, you know, like, how do they attribute the work, how do university lecturers attribute the work in their PowerPoints, do they, don't they, do they put it in the survey properly? I mean, these are all things that I've failed at. You know, like when I was, you know, lecturing, I don't know if I always attributed, I don't know if I always put things into surveys. I wasn't really aware of it. And, I guess I'm coming with the zealousness of a convert, is that, you know, only once I was on the board of copyright agency did I know about these statutory licences. I mean, it was quite recent, you know, it's only been in the last few years, so I can be forgiven and you guys can be forgiven and absolved as well. But, like, we do have to take them on as they come on.
Yeah, exactly. I would love to hear some questions from ARIES, particularly because we didn't get to hear from a lot of ARIES in the previous discussion. And I particularly want to hear questions from ARIES about something that we often talk about at NAVA, is that people who are actively involved in ARIES tend to be the ones who are upholding artists' rights more strongly and clearly than other institutions. And it's partly because you're artists, it's partly because you are, you know, wanting to, as you said earlier, the structures, the frameworks and the tactics that actually, you know, push and develop the idea. Are there any artists here who want to ask a question or give us an example of challenging or fighting or defending artists' rights in the ways that you've set up your decision making or your structures? Or even some, you know, recent doozy kind of examples of lately. Anyone from any RE scratching their chin?
Yes.
Just over there. Yes, I know, but I ask those guys and then we'll go to down there.
It's on. This is a very just particular example without talking about some of the more complex stuff of what's important in an RE and how they see copyright, but often find that the arts organisations that I've worked, not necessarily the high-end ones, are worse in trying to convince that following these processes are, or to remind them to follow these processes are useful. For example, last year, I lived in the Northern Territory and I was involved in an art space up there. And when you're involved in our space, generally you're involved in a lot of different community spaces. They might be arts organisations, they might actually be community spaces, it might be council. And there's a local festival up there that runs every year in the Springs. And last year when I went back, I realised that they'd taken and I'd worked with them previously to develop a concept for that festival. And in good faith that it would be used just for that particular festival. Last year I went up and they'd taken that particular image and just reused it from its back catalogue without attribution. And I guess trying to tie this back into what might be important for an artist that works in an artist-run space or in those processes when perhaps you're not necessarily motivated by the commercial gains that you might get in establishing these relationships, which I wasn't, but as soon as I was disenfranchised from the decision-making around that image by an arts organisation, it sort of makes it really starkly clear that there's something really dysfunctional within the ecosystem. Like, that to me was more disturbing than trying to convince someone in council that these are important rights to adhere to. I also noticed this year that that particular organisation is struggling to attribute images to artists or musicians within that particular festival. But what I did do when I noticed that on Instagram just last week is I wrote to them and referenced NAGA and arts law. I guess from an RA perspective or a young artist, I'm still a little bit unsure as to what, or confident in what NAGA and arts law can do for us. I think it's quite fledgling at the moment and quite hopeful, but I did feel quite empowered in like referring this organisation to look at something solid and say, hey, here's the standard. This isn't just me complaining or wanting money, because I don't want money. I just want some power in the decision making.
Yeah, and recognition.
Maybe not even recognition, because I think there's something about making work, particularly in public space, in the way that artists refer to other artists' work, that might tap into like a cultural common, which is, I think, not really about commercial gain.
I meant broadly more cultural recognition.
I think you just touched on a number of really important points. In particular, like when, even though we might not know the full, the letter of the law about something, when we feel that something is wrong, that our rights have been infringed, that something has been reused, misattributed, etc., when we have that gut instinct feeling, chances are it's wrong. And then there are people to get on the phone with and have that conversation, and then be able to, you know, have us speak to whoever that was, and make sure that that can change. But I think that's, you know, that in essence is the great importance of a national network and membership-based organisation, because we can't all know, every aspect of the code of practice, or we can't all necessarily be in that position of being our best advocate and defender, especially in situations where we're in smaller places, we all know each other, we're worried about, you know, offence and misunderstanding and so on. Especially when we feel ourselves in that position of, oh, they're going to think I'm complaining. These aren't personal things. These are the basics of our rights, and all of those basics build to that critical mass that makes, you know, a way of working that's fair for everyone. You know, it's so important. Thank you for raising that example. There was another one that was down here. Yes.
Hi, Diane Taylor again from Western Australia. I came specifically all the way from Perth to try and bring something out of 45 years worth of practice as a professional artist to the Code of Ethics. And in the practice that I've watched across Australia as well as US, I find that the biggest thing we have to protect ourselves from, and Oliver, you might be able to help with this, is can we put into the Code of Ethics something that actually defines for the consumer what is an original work in any genre of the arts, what is an original work and what isn't. And it's becoming, with the digital work and increasing part of the market and reproductions out of China, a bigger confusion. The secondary market will fail because of it. If we don't be careful in the next couple of years, because it'll become obvious in the secondary market because of the instability of unarchival work. If we don't do something to protect the authenticity of an original piece, a one-off piece of original artwork, and maybe put something that defines that into our systems as a code of practice, our industry is going to suffer more and more.
What I would just say is that there are lots of rights and lots of ways of looking at that ethics. One of them is legal, but you know, we are talking about the legal a lot, but it's not the only set of rights that we have. You know, there is like a common sense thing of, you know, not telling you when your work was being done. Like, yes, that's against the right, but it's just also just not, you know, not a very kind thing to do.
Well, it's like Peter White showing the slide earlier, just be a good person.
Yeah.
But then we also need frameworks that support the being a good person. Because some people need guidance in the being good.
But the legal answer to that is that there's a lot of case law on what constitutes a original work, and all over the world.
Put it into the code of ethics.
Yeah.
Well,
thanks, Di. This actually came up as a dispute in another office, I think last year, when someone called. There was a an art competition, art prize, and printmaking was excluded because it was considered to not be original.
Oh, I see.
So we were looking for a definition of what is a print, and how to define a print when a print is an original and when a print is a reproduction. So we have had conversations and we have noted that that is something to address in the code.
Okay.
Yeah.
I would just, wary where people tell you to waive things. I mean, that's something that I just want to, when we all go into art prizes that say, oh, and by the way, we're going to use this for advertising, but does then advertising mean advertising the prize, or does it mean then you can also be used on the sponsor's wine? Because that's also part of the advertising of the prize. Like, these are the sorts of things that we have to be really sort of vigilant around. And, just sort of look where the usage is. Something with moral rights, reproducibility. For example, if somebody puts something on a tea towel or on a coffee cup, obviously that printing is not going to be at such a high level as if it's done as a proper print. And is that, is that going to be against your moral rights or not? Is that something that you're willing to live with, to have it on a coffee cup, or is that going to actually destroy the quality and essence of your artwork? So they're the sorts of questions, and I think that they are legal questions, or in Australia and in the West they're framed as legal questions, but they're also just questions for the arts community in general. There's never a straight answer, and as I think was mentioned before, we don't all have the money to pursue the case. And arts law, the question was, what can arts law and NAVA do? Well, they can't pursue every precedent, set in case. So if they've got 100, I don't know what the figures are, but not every case can be pursued. And then cases that are pursued, sometimes you get nominal damages and, you don't get that money back. And, so there's a risk in all of these things. So I think the answer is probably something that's extra legal, which is just to make sure the culture and the ecosystem are very strong and robust, so that we don't actually have to take things to court, so that we can turn around and say, well, here's the code of ethics. If you want to talk to arts law about it, you can. Can we come to some compromise without going to court, really? I mean, that's sort of where we want to be.
Now, Gabrielle from Indigenous Art Code has a question. You were thinking of the microphone to you, but while we're getting that to you, again, we need, strong codes of practice so that artists don't have to run around defending cases, because we don't even get to that point. We try and prevent getting to that point. And I think one of the big issues, Robin's not again, one of the big issues, and it also goes to Di's question, as Holly and Penelope clarified around prints, the code of practice has got specific chapters about where transactions take place, about where a work is used, about the particular contract that an artist is getting into. Just as I was saying before, and the question of Patricia and others about, we're not going to regulate how a work of art is defined. We're not purporting to regulate the way that artistic practice works, but we certainly want to strengthen the ways in which artists exchange, transact, get into contracts, and so on. And so that question of what constitutes an original work, we have to make sure that when an artist is contracted for whatever purpose, particularly when it's about commissioning, particularly when it's about entering competition, that the work is clearly defined. And this leads on from the question around public art. This is the work now. How is it going to be maintained? How is it going to be cleaned into the future? If it's about a print, if it's about a work that is being commissioned that doesn't yet exist? How do we define it so that the artistic intent is maintained throughout the making process, and we get to the end and the commission isn't saying, well, that's not what I wanted? So it's in the context where rights are upheld or otherwise that we have to be able to act. Gabrielle's got a point, and there might have been another one down here. Excellent, the lady who's standing. Gabrielle.
I think you both just covered in what you said, but it's really about being preventive.
Yeah.
And since launching the Fake Art campaign and Copyright Agency and Artists Law, the number of issues that are being brought to the code aren't about fake art, but they're about appalling licensing arrangements that Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander artists have entered into. And I think what we've learned from that is, you know, just because something's legal doesn't mean it's fair.
That's right.
And the law can't always fix that. And there are so many Indigenous artists that are in the most appalling licensing arrangements, but they entered into agreements, and it's very hard, even with the best legal advice that, you know, money doesn't even need to buy, with, you know, arts laws assistance, there isn't a lot they can always do about it. And, you know, then what that does to the supply chain for all of us, knowing that there are these products and merchandise and other things out there that there is a legal agreement, but the artist, you know, the arrangement is terrible, and there's not a whole lot that can be done, short of, you know, me getting scared of defamation every day for maybe saying things about particular businesses that aren't doing the right thing. So be preventative, you know. Takes a lot less time to go to arts law in the first instance or copyright agency than to, you know, end up with something shocking that you might not be able to do anything about.
Hear, hear. Thank you. We have got a question here, and then Zoe has a question there.
Just something practical, because this has made me decide that the next board meeting we're going to have a review of our copyright practices and maybe talk to our artists, or maybe try to get a workshop organised so that they're far more aware of what their rights are. At a very, very basic level, one of the things for me that just is problematic from what you've been raising is, well, we have an opening. I will go around and I'll talk to the artists, and I might take pictures and ask them if it's okay to post them on Instagram in terms of our site. And they will be attributed, but sometimes it'll be an extract rather than the full image, for instance. Okay, so far that sounds like it's okay because they're agreeing, but what happens then once that is on Instagram, and what occurs to the transference of an image after that process? Because then there's no control over it whatsoever, surely.
So, like, it's the choice of an art, like, obviously a lot of artists use Instagram, I use Instagram, everyone, you know, so we have sort of given over some of that control, but we haven't given over our copyright. And it's up to us when we, so for example, I mean, you know, there's lots of examples, but like, you know, the Richard Prince, I mean, Instagram changed their policy recently, didn't they, a few years ago.
Richard Prince is America, remember?
Yeah.
You don't want that in Australia.
No,
do you?
No.
Good
point.
So, no,
example
so of where an artist's work was repurposed.
Just taken off Instagram straight away.
Yeah, in the way that the artist would in no way improved on. Of course, did not improve it, because in the US they have that so-called fair use approach. Courts deemed that that was appropriate. Google, what was the name of the work? There was a whole series, and it involved First Nations people and the condition in which they had been photographed. It's, yeah, this is, yeah. Not good.
Yes.
Sorry.
What's the problem?
There are two cases. They're different cases. One was the Instagram case, and the other one was taking Carew's work, a photographer, and putting it, and Richard Prince blew them up and put fluoro guitars and things like that. So both of those cases was under fair use, and they were okay. It couldn't happen in Australia because we don't have fair use, and we don't want fair use.
Absolutely. Thank you, Robin.
Sorry,
Zoe has a question and has the microphone.
Sorry, mine's not a question, I'm going to make a statement.
Remember though, if you lift your voice at the end, a question.
Mine's just a shout out to Ari's in terms of the preventative side of things. We've recently done a whole bunch of policies and procedures and found that they're incredibly helpful, surprisingly, despite how horrible that is. people have done for me, and I think that's just good to know that we should work together.
So great, because once you've gone through that process, and you're right, like, it's not the easiest, most fun thing in the world, because you really want to get it right. Imagine the years of work that went into, you know, developing the code in the first place, and we are going to put years of work into that revision, but then you want it to be of the best use to so many people. So thank you for offering that, Zoe. That is really fantastic. Oh, were you going to say no? That is cool. We've got time for maybe one more question, and if you have to, maybe you had her hand up earlier. Thank you.
I'm thinking about
the microphone really close to your mouth.
Can you hear?
Yeah.
Yes. I'm thinking about the two things. One, the photography case of the Hope image, which was so instrumental in garnering support during Obama's campaign. And there was a huge court case in America. And my understanding is that it was sampled from the internet or appropriated, and that the artist who used the photograph didn't attribute and had to pay a huge, when it was discovered, had to pay a huge damage bill. So it looks like there is some redress in the US over, you know, this taking of images from the internet. The other thing is, as a sometimes printmaker, I have a real problem with the word lithography, because photographic lithography means you can get everything from, you know, Picasso's and all sorts of things that are so-called lithographs that the public is having the wall pulled over their eyes. They think that this has come off a press, has been pulled by the artist, etc. And they're getting prices that for original and contemporary printmakers are not able to attract. One of my lithographs the other day, I put it in a bath of water. So, and because that the quality of the ink and the process, that was fine, just dried, you know, so it was in complete bath of water. You take it out, you make sure you put something heavy on it, and it's still fine. The sort of photographic, lithographic crap that is being sent and sold on the internet for huge sums of money, I think it's an issue what's happening is poor old printers are getting a bad reputation because of the shonky practitioners. Mm-hmm. So it's just something that, you know, this definition of what is an art print, what is just crap, you know, it needs to be done.
See, I think that is less a legal question. I mean, it's a question for us as a community to explain that, you know.
The problem is that because there are so many of these crappy things out there now, that in about 5 years, people who have, like, I'm thinking back to the 2000 Olympics, okay? Village. I saw them in Sydney, a huge shot through of his photographs that he'd signed, and they were limited edition photographic prints of his own artwork. People bought these, the limited edition print, thinking, oh yeah, you know, this has got some quality. If you look at these Village prints now, as I have, they're all purple and blue and they're crap. So what will happen is that in 10 years, what's being bought today will deteriorate, and the reputation of artists per se will go down the toilet. So we have to keep up our standards. And I'm really sick of going to markets where people are selling photographic prints as art prints, because they're wrecking the reputation of many of us.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with that. So, I mean, I think what the whole point of this session really is that we can use whatever mechanisms we have, whether they're legal mechanisms, cultural mechanisms, government policy mechanisms, to sort of leverage the respect and understanding of the arts community to the best we can. And I think that my point is really that all of us here have to use all those mechanisms at our disposal, make ourselves aware of what the mechanisms are so that we can use them. Arts Last Law is waiting for our call. NAVA's waiting for, to help us with the code of practice, and that, you know, we all have to sort of make sure that we're part of that system.
I think also something that you touch on, which a lot of us have had a lot of different conversations about over the years, in particular, I'm thinking of some years ago, I used to run Craft Victoria in Victoria, obviously, and that's a place with gallery and a shop, and also does support and professional services for makers and designers. And because up until that time, the most time I had spent in a shop where I could find the work of the maker was as a buyer and not as a seller, I was just not used to, not ready for, the number of volume of conversations that my colleagues and I were having every day with people who walked in and were saying, well, why is that so expensive? I can get this from name mass-produced, shop, supermarket, whatever, for this price. And at first you can be like, your heart sinks a little bit, okay, they haven't quite understood what this work actually is. And then you kind of, you inhale, you take that deep breath and go, this is an opportunity to talk to someone about what craft practice is, what it means to make something, what it means to ask a question about where did these materials come from, what is the longevity of this object, what's the place of an object or a print work or a work that is hung or displayed, what's the role of objects in our lives, in cultural practice. We think about the Fake Art Hunts culture campaign that Gabrielle mentioned earlier. All those questions that we need to ask when we're buying work that says that it is Aboriginal or Aboriginal style. Who made it? In what conditions? Were they connected with an Aboriginal art centre? Did those artists sign a contract in a language that they understood? What's the connection between the person selling you this and the place, the context in which that work was made for the first time? All of these questions are not just about all of us and our livelihoods and our careers, but they're about our past and the future of our nation. How do we make things? Why do we make things? Why do we make work? How do we create meaning through the way that we practice our culture, our art form, the rigor that we develop through our practice, through university? These are all the conversations that if we're engaged in them every day, that's actually how we, it's not just how we create the future, but it's how we change the world. And so, of course, we're going to be exasperated having those conversations, and that's where we draw on one another. But the more we have exactly those conversations, the better advocates we are about the broader ethics of what those objects underlie. Why are we not protecting the environment by thinking about the objects we're making and throwing every day? Why are we not understanding that we're sitting on land whose sovereignty was never ceded? All of this is why we're here and why we're in this together. It's why we need a code to support the transactions, but it's also why we need the confidence of ourselves and each other to have these conversations about our rights. Now, we're going to thank Ollie in just a sec, but there's a lot that I'm going to tell you about this afternoon and tomorrow. Some of it's a bit boring, but it's really, really important. So, well, first of all, I'll come to the fun part. We're going to have drinks at 5:30 downstairs, which is going to be really fantastic. I want to thank the Copyright Agency really explicitly, because if it wasn't for them and their investment in these 2 days, it really couldn't have happened. And so a big round of applause for the Copyright Agency. Thank you so, so very much. Tomorrow we're going to be at Parliament House. Now, Parliament House, for those who remember Old Parliament House and New Parliament House, Old Parliament House, as I can remember with, the amnesia that settles in, just over my age, was this wonderland where you could just walk in, you run into politicians, have a bit of a chat because the two houses faced each other. But now we've got this other thing where, this new Parliament House and the wall that's gone up, and it's also under, this renovation that's happening. There is a massive security palaver to get into Parliament House in the first place. So we have had to, as we've let you know in the emails, we've had to provide
everyone's names ahead of time tomorrow. There is a security check to go through, which is basically like going through the X-ray thing at the airport, exactly. But to get your pass to get in, you will need some photo ID. So please have that, find that when you go through the thing, have it ready, because it's just going to take us ages to get in, and we want to be able to start on time. There's going to be tea and coffee served there from 8 o'clock in the morning, which, you know, fantastic. We want to start on time at 9. So please imagine you're getting on some really exciting international flight. You're going to get there early, show your ID, and get in, and then we will, you know, get to start. And we've got such a great day tomorrow. We're going to start summing up about today. We've covered so much today, and Melvin and I are going to give a bit of the summary of what we talked about. We're going to hear from Justine Van Gorik, who is the curator of the Parliament House collection, to hear about the role of the visual arts in Parliament House. And she says something really fantastic, which I'm hoping she's going to say tomorrow, because I want it tattooed on our brains, that